Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And again, thank you to all of our witnesses for your heroism and your bravery that day, and also for being here today and telling your story. And I certainly join the chairman and every member of this committee in our commitment to making sure we get to the truth and that those who did this are accountable. Officer Gunnell, I'd like to ask you, you describe in your testimony that it was, you said it was like a medieval battlefield, that what you were subjected to that day was something like a medieval battlefield. You said we fought hand to hand and inch by inch to prevent an invasion of the Capitol by a violent mob intent on subverting our democratic process. And is it the case that as you were fighting there, you were not aware that the Capitol had been breached elsewhere? I believe you said that you really thought that was, you were the last line of defense. Is that right?
That is correct, ma'am.
And so, Officer Gunnell, when you think Sergeant. About that and share with us the vivid memory of the cruelty and the violence of the assault that day, and then you hear former President Trump say, quote, "It was a loving crowd. There was a lot of love in the crowd." How does that make you feel?
It's upsetting. It's a pathetic excuse for his behavior, for something that he himself helped to create, this monstrosity. I'm still recovering from those hugs and kisses that day that he claimed that so many rioters, terrorists, were assaulting us that day. If that was hugs and kisses, then we should all go to his house and do the same thing to him. To me, it's insulting, it's demoralizing, because everything that we did was to prevent everyone in the Capitol from getting hurt. And what he was doing, instead of sending the military, instead of sending the support or telling his people, his supporter, to stop this nonsense, he egged them to continue fighting. I was in the lowest, worst terrorist fighting alongside these officers. And all of them were telling us, Trump sent us. Nobody else, there was nobody else. It was not Antifa, it was not Black Lives Matter, it was not the FBI, it was his supporter that he sent them over to the Capitol that day. And he could have done a lot of things. One of them was to tell them to stop. He talks about sacrifices, whatnot. The only thing that he has sacrificed is the institutions of the country and the country itself, only for his ego, because he wants to continue. He wants the job, but he doesn't want to do the job. And that's a shame on him and himself.
Thank you. Officer Fanone, you talked in your testimony about the fact that the line that day was the seat of American democracy, was the seat of our government. Can you talk about, as you think now about what was under threat, first of all, did you know it? Did you have a sense at the time as you were going through the battle before the horrific violence happened to you of the nature of the gravity of the threat that we were facing, that the line was, in fact, the seat of American democracy?
Well, my response that day really was based off of my obligation as a police officer to not only protect the lives of the members of Congress and their staff, but also to my fellow officers. The politics of that day really didn't play into my response at all.
Thank you. Officer Hodges, in your testimony, you talk about when you were at the Ellipse, and you mentioned the significant number of men dressed in tactical gear attending the gathering, wearing ballistic vests, helmet, goggles. When you saw that, was that something that you had anticipated at all? And could you just tell us more about that crowd there at the Ellipse, the extent to which you saw people who clearly were in military or paramilitary garb?
It was absolutely a source of concern. Like I said, they had outer carrier vests designed to carry ballistic shielding, helmets, goggles, face masks, backpacks filled with unknown objects. And I couldn't get a count, and we couldn't stop and search everyone. But so I don't know how many there were, but I know that, you know, it was obviously a concern of mine.
Thank you very much. And then finally, Officer Dunn, you mentioned the text message that you received, you expressed some surprise. You mentioned that you had not seen any intelligence that would have led you to believe that we should expect that kind of violence. Could you elaborate on that a little bit?
Yes, ma'am. So we were expecting civil disobedience as we do at the Capitol. At least that was what was relayed to us. A couple of arrests, name calling, you know, unfriendly people, but nowhere near the level of violence or even close to it like that we experienced. When I received the text message, it made the hairs on my neck rise, but since our chain of command had not told us to prepare for any of these levels of violence, I was just like, okay, whatever. Like, I've been here, I start year 14 in November, and we've dealt with hundreds of protests where people get arrested, and peaceful First Amendment protests. Everybody has the right to protest. That's okay, do what you do, and you know, we'll arrest you if you break the law, and we'll go home later that night. It was a lot different than that, but I was not alerted to the level of violence. Like, the text message I got foreshadowed that, looking back, but no, we were not prepared for what we faced that day.
Thank you. And Mr. Chairman, without objection, I'd like to ask unanimous consent if we could enter that complete text message into the record.
Without objection.
Thank you. Ordered. And again, I would just like to express my deep gratitude for what you all did to save us. It won't be forgotten, and we will get to the bottom of this. Thank you very much. With that, I yield back.